Well, we considered x a normal flat, proper flat scheme over Z. Of dimension 2, with smooth complex points, and now we have two Hermitian line models. On X, then to these two line models we can attach a real number, which is called the arithmetic intersection of L bar and M bar. So we gave an explicit formula for the intersection number. That was the main content of the lecture last time. And then we made a conjecture, which is the following. So we consider K a number field. S, the spectrum of the ring of integers in K. I will take the following definition. D of K will mean the logarithm of the absolute value of the discriminant of K over Q. So that's the definition of an invariant of K. Now, assume I have a semi-stable curve over S. Such that the genus of the Riemann surface XC is positive, then we have omega, which is a relative dualizing sheaf, of X over S. So this is a line model on X, which on the smooth part is the relative differentials. And Arakelov defined a metric on omega. And I gave a definition of this metric. So let's call omega 2 the self-intersection of omega bar. So this is a real number, an invariant of the arithmetic surface X. We said that it's a theorem of Ullmo that omega 2 bar is positive. And we made a conjecture. About an upper bound for omega 2. So assume g equals 6, and we shall see today why g equals 6. Then, for every positive real number epsilon, there exists a constant, beta of epsilon, such that omega 2 is at most 3 over 2 plus epsilon times dk plus beta epsilon times k over q. The constant beta epsilon is assumed to vary in a bounded way when taking x in a projective family. And we shall see a more specific application of this condition today. So we announce the following theorem, that if we have the conjecture B, if conjecture B holds, then the ABC conjecture is true, where ABC means precise epsilon, 1 plus epsilon exponent in the bound on the, well, if we have A plus B equals C, then C is less than the constant times N 1 plus epsilon. The point was to have the correct exponent in the ABC conjecture. So this is essentially what we did last time. And we started to state and prove a lemma which goes as follows. So again, K is a number field. S is the spectrum over K. And now we consider Y a smooth projective curve over K. So we have a curve on the field K. We can define the Picard group, which is isomorphism classes of Lie models equipped with the operation of tensor product and taken modulo isomorphism of Lie models. So it's Picard of Y is a set of isomorphism classes of Lie models on Y with the tensor product as an operation. So we assume that there is a model of this picture. So YS is a proper curve over S, which is a model. So YS tensor K OS is Y. Then we have an arithmetic Picard group, which is the set of Hermitian Lie models on YS. The operation is the tensor product. Of course, we can take the tensor product of two metrics to get the metric and the tensor product of Lie models. And this is modulo isomorphism, where isomorphism between L bar and M bar means that L and M are isomorphic and the isomorphism preserves the metric. Okay. So we do the following construction. We assume, well, I should have, assume we have a finite extension of K we write T for the spectrum of OF. And we suppose that we have a point in YF. A point on Y defined over F. Then, by the evaluative criterion of compactness, of properness, then we have a morphism from T to YS, which generically is given by the point. On peak of Y, I have a map which is called the degree. Let me write in degree index K. If I have a line bundle on a smooth projective curve, I have its degree. I mean, if you are of a complex number, you can just consider the integral of C1 of the line bundle. But it exists algebraically, it's given by the number of zeros minus the number of poles. So we have the degree from the Picard group of Y to Z. And the lemma says the following. Let XS a class in the Picard group of YS tensor Q. Assume that the restriction of XS to the generic fiber of YS over S, which is Y by assumption, assume X satisfies the condition that the degree is negative, then for any point, any number field extension of K, for any point P in YK, in YF, we have an inequality, namely the degree, the arithmetic degree of the restriction of XS to T. We have U morphism from T to YS, and here we have XS, a class in the arithmetic Picard group of YS. We pull it back, and we get a real number, which is the arithmetic degree of the pullback. We assume that generically the degree is negative, and you conclude that this is less or equal to O of R, where O of R means constant tamar, where the constant does not depend on the choice of F or P. So that's the lemma. And let's see how it's proved. We are taking XS in the Picard group of YS tensor Q, but this means that a multiple of XS is a line model, Hermitian line model, and we can certainly take a multiple in order to prove the lemma. So we can assume that that XS is a class of a line bundle, but I will be interested in the dual line bundle. So the line bundle L of OS, LS to OS bar. So this is the dual of an Hermitian line bundle LS. So if we consider X, which is LS over Y, the degree K of X so we consider the dual, so it's the same as the dual of the restriction of L to S. And the degree of X is negative. So the degree of X is minus the degree of the line bundle L. So L is such that its degree is negative. The degree of L, excuse me, is positive. We are on a curve, so to have a positive degree means that L is ample. On the other hand, we are considering, we can consider the inverse image of L bar S and its degree. We write it as HLS of P. And this is kind of height for the point P. P is a rational point, an algebraic point on the curve. And the height of it is obtained by pulling back the Hermitian line bundle LS and taking the degree on T. So this is what is called the faulting site of P.
This is a definition.
So what we are saying is that if L is ample, the faulting site is bounded from below, because we shall take minus XS. So assume L is ample, then the faulting site is bounded from below. So we wrote a paper with Bost and Gillet. Where we prove these conditions that if the line bundle is ample, then the faulting site is bounded from below. So let me give a hint for the proof of this assertion. So L is ample, so there exists some big power of L such that L to the n is O of 1 for some projective embedding of Y in PK. So here we have O of 1, and O of 1 has a metric which is the uh, Fubini study metric on the Lie model. So that's the metric on O of 1. Well, the remark is that the height with respect to O of 1 with the Fubini study metric is positive. This is given by explicit formula, log of sum of square divided by 1 square, so it's positive. Now, we can compare the Fubini study metric with a metric which is given on L. So assume that L bar is O of 1 times H, where H is a Fubini study metric multiplied by a function exponential of phi, where phi is a smooth function on the complex point of Y. If I have two metrics, I can look at the quotient of these two metrics and I will get a C-infinity function. But now, YC is compact. So phi is bounded. So the two metric H and Fubini study are equal up to bounded amount. And this is all we need to get a lower bound for the height of P with respect to LS. We still have to do something at finite spaces. And at finite spaces, all I will say is that LS differs from omega 1 by bounded amount . I will not give the full proof of that . So we have that the Fubini study height is positive and the height and model we consider differs from Fubini study by bounded amount. So we know that the height of P is not positive, but at least bounded from below by some expressions like AR. So this is what we prove in details in this paper with Bost and Gillet. But this is nothing else than the degree U upper star of XS minus AR. So we get that the degree of U upper star XS is at most A times R. And this is the lemma. So the theory of heights and the fact that they vary by bounded amount when you change the metric or you change the model of the Lie model, this fact implies the lemma. That is, before Arakelov theory, the theory of white of height was modulo bounded amount. One defines the height, which is called the logarithmic height, which I will come to in a minute, which is well defined up to O of 1. Because when you change the metric of the model, you don't want the height to change too much, It changes by a bounded amount. Okay. Now we'll do some construction which will relate the height of a point to omega 2 or some curve. And this is a construction due to Kadayar. So I will talk about Kadayar vibration. So this is the following. Assume I have a number field which I call K0. Assume I have a curve, a smooth projective geometrically connected curve over K0. And I assume that the genus of C is 2. Then we have the following theorem of Kadayar. Which is explained in an article of Martin Deschamps. Which is the following. There exists an finite extension of K, 0, alpha an étale morphism, finite étale map over K, and on Y2 we have a family of curves. So C is a curve, Y2 is a curve, and Y2 will be the basis of a family of curves. So we get a surface with a basis Y2. So there exists a finite étale map of this kind, and a morphism which shall we write pi 2 from x2 to y2, a smooth morphism. With fibers, curve of genus 6. So pi 2 is supposed to be non-isotrivial. That is, you cannot trivialize pi 2 by some finite extension of y2. And the fibers of phi 2 are smooth proper geometrically connected curve of genus 6. So the genus I will call gamma. So this is the way why this is why six come in. I mean, we start with a curve of genus 2, we have this family, and the fibers of genus 6. So let me explain this construction of quadrilia. So k has to be large enough for the existence of pi 2. So we consider k, and we call y0 the curve obtained by extending scalars from k0 to k. Now we consider y1 to y0, a degree 2, etal cover. So this might not exist on K0, but when K is large enough, there exists non-trivial degree 2 etal cover of the curve Y0. If I consider the genus of Y1, well, since I have a tile cover, I have 2g1 minus 2 equals 2, 2g minus 2, where g is a genus of y0. So from this, since g equals 2, you get g1 equals 3. So we have a curve of degree 3, which is an etal cover of degree 2 of this curve of genus 2. We call J1 the Jacobian of Y1. And we do a second construction, which is the following. We consider the multiplication by 2 in the Jacobian. We assume that K is large enough for X1 to be contained in J1 by choosing a point. So we have X1 go to J1. We consider a cover by the multiplication by 2 in the Jacobian. And we consider a connected component of the fiber product. So we call Y1 here and Y1 here. So we consider Y2 to be a connected component of the fiber product, so of Y1 cross G1 over G1, where here I have multiplication by 2. So we can consider the product of y1 with itself, so it's a surface, of course. And in this surface, we have a divisor, which I call gamma, which is the product of y1 with itself over y0. So 2 points in y1 with the same image in y0. So for instance, we can look at the diagonal where we have twice the same point. We can also look at the graph of the multiplication by two. So we have in fact two components in gamma. One is the diagonal, the other one is the graph. But in any case, gamma is a divisor in y1 cross y1. Now we look at the map from y2 cross y1 in y1 cross y1. And we call gamma tilde the inverse image of gamma in this surface.
What is the arrow y2 cross y1 to y1 cross y1? Y2
is the last curve we considered. It maps to y1 by definition. So y2 cross y1 maps to y1 cross y1. What is your question? Maybe I should write things upside down. Y2 cross Y1 is larger than Y1 cross Y1. Okay. And then there is the following fact, which is proved in the references I'm telling you. If K, the number field, is large enough, there exist a Lyme bundle L over Y2 cross Y1 such that the square of L is the Lyme bundle attached to this divisor gamma tilde. So it's O of gamma tilde, the Lyme bundle, so we have a divisor, attached to the divisor we have a Lyme bundle, and the fact is that this Lyme bundle has a square root. So this is following the construction that to get this property. So we choose L according to this equation. And then there exists a surface which map to Y2. Well, in fact, it maps to y2 cross y1. The morphism is degree 2. And it's parametrified along gamma tilde.
Excuse me, in order to define the map from y1 to j1, do you need the original point on y1?
We shall map x2 to y2 by taking the first projection. Is it your question?
No, I mean the map from y1 to j1, do you need an original point?
It's given by the choice of a point. This map here, it's the inclusion of a curve in its Jacobian For this, you have to choose a point on y1.
Yes, so you need a regional point.
So k is large enough here.
So we make some choices in the construction. For instance, at this step we choose a point. And now we choose L. So the construction will not be canonical. It will depend on some choices. So on y2 cross y1, I have this divisor gamma tilde. I choose the square root of this divisor, namely L, and then I get a surface which is a morphism of degree 2 ramified along gamma tilde. So this is a standard construction when you study cyclic covers of curves. So the construction of x2 is as follows. We call L the total space of the Lie model L. So L maps to y2 cross y1 by a morphism called rho. And we can consider two sections, namely we have the section on L of the pullback of L curl L. By tautology, if I am in L, I have chosen a section of the Lie model L. So that's the tautological section. Now, consider T, which is a section on y2 cross y1 of O of gamma tilde. So the canonical section of a... I have a divider on the surface, therefore I have a Lie model, and this Lie model is given by a section. With the section. Here is the definition of x2. The divisor in L. So L was relative dimension 1 on y2 cross y1. So y2 cross y1 is dimension 2 and L is dimension 3. We have a divisor in L, which is the divisor of equation S squared equals phi upper star of T, rho upper star of T. So we look in the space attached to the Lie model L on y2 cross y1, it's a dimension 3 manifold. And on this manifold, we define a divisor by this equation, S square equals rho star of T. And the general theory of cyclic covers says that this construction attaches to a square root of the degree 2 cover ramified along gamma tilde. And this is a bijection to give the line the square root or to give the cover is equivalent. Okay. So now we have x2. It maps by the projection of L to a2 cross a1 to this product. Here I have the first projection, 2i2, and by definition, the composite is what I call pi2. So this is the map in the statement of the theorem. So we can show that this is not isotrivial. I mean, we are not taking only products. At some point, we are actually doing something. So we don't have a product family. It's not isotrivial. And we can consider the fibers of pi 2. So we consider a point, let's say, in y2 k bar. We can consider the inverse image. And the situation is this. I have taken a fiber on the first component. Therefore, it maps to the second component. So x to y maps to y1 by the first projection. The second projection, excuse me. So it's a map of degree 2. And since x2 to y2 is ramified, the same is true for the fibers. The fibers x2 y to y1 is ramified at 2 points. So it's ramified along y cross y1 intersection lambda tilde, and this consists of 2 points. Gamma tilde has 2 components, the diagonal and the graph of the involution. If I take the intersection with y cross y1, I will get 2 points. Okay? So we call gamma the genus of the fiber. There is a so-called Urvis formula. I don't know, there's a T in Urvis. Which tells us how to find the genus of a ramified cover. So I get the following, 2 gamma minus 2 is equal to twice 2g1 minus 2 plus the ramification. So the ramification has index 2, 2 minus 1, twice. So I get plus 2 by the ramification of the morphism from x to y to y1. So g1 is 3, hence gamma is 6. Here is number 6. So let me remind you the notation. We have a curve c over k0. We consider y0, which is c times k over k0. We have a cover, etal cover of degree 2 by y1. And then we have an etal cover of y1 such that there exists a family of curves on Y2 with curve of genus 6. So what we have to do now is to choose models for these varieties of a number field. Because we want to do height and so forth, therefore we have to work on ring of integers. So let S be the spectrum of OK, and we want to extend the quadratic construction to S over S. So the first thing we can do is the following. So it's a statement which I learned from Abramovich. It's the following. If alpha from y2 to y1 is large enough, that is to say, I can replace y2 to y1 by y prime 2 to y1, where y prime 2 to y2 is a natural cover. I have the freedom of making y2 a little bigger. So by doing so, we have the following property. For any finite extension f of k, for any point p in y2f, the fiber pi 2 minus 1 of p has a stable model on t equals spec of f. So this is a general statement of existence of stable models. I mean, this is well known when the basis is dimension 1. By a finite extension, I can always assume semi-stability. This is, I forgot the name of that. So here we do it in a family by a eta cover of y1. We make an eta cover of y2, and then we have the existence of models. For every point, we have a model. But we want something more, namely, we want a model for the family. So, to do this, we use a second fact, which is due to Mireille Deschamps in the paper, Mireille Martin Deschamps in the paper I quoted. Which is that at least we can extend the picture to an urban neighborhood. That is, exist U in X, an urban subset, such that the map from X2 to Y2 extends over U. This means that we have a map X2U goes to y2u over the open subset u. I mean, this is usually the case if you make a construction generically, that at least on some open, the construction will be the same. But of course, bad thing can happen outside you. So now we would like to compactify the picture. So x2u over s is some compactification of the map y2u goes to u. I mean, there are singularities in y2u outside the inverse image of u. And now there is another theorem which is due to Abramovich and Ort. Is that we can extend the model by some alteration. So exists an alteration. I will define this in a minute. So it's a morphism phi s from ys to yu bar. It's a morphism of s. And a stable curve XS over YS. So after some alteration, we are able to extend the family to a stable family. So YS is dimension 2 now of the scheme, and XS is dimension 3. So the result of Abramovich and Ort is the existence of XS. An alteration means the following. When phi s is proper, surjective and generically finite. There is some famous work of De Jong who replaces resolution of singularities by alteration of singularities in all characteristics. So the same type of construction is done by Abramovich and Ort to extend a stable family from the generic fiber to a model. So if I think of this picture, so I call phi s, pi s the morphism here. And generically, I have pi from x to y. Generically, I have this family of stable curve over the curve y. This maps to Y2, and here I have pi 2, which I constructed in the previous hour, and this diagram is commutative. is Cartesian. This x is the Cartesian product of x2 and y over y2. What happens is that stable models are unique. So whatever construction you give of stable models, there is only one. And here you can either construct it by Ort-Abramovich construction or by pulling back the stable curve x2 over y2. Okay. So this is the end of the Kodaira vibration construction. And now I want to prove the main step in the proof of theorem B, that is ABC. And the step we take is called effective model. You know that Faltings proves that a curve of genus at least 2 has finitely many points, but there is no bound known on the size of this point. An effective model would give a bound on the size of the solutions.
The height or the size?
What?
The number of solutions or the height?
The height. The number of solutions, there is a bound, which is not very good, but there is a bound. What is not known is to bound the coordinate of a solution. So,
what when you say the size, it was not clear.
Yes, yes. So I will say that I will show that under conjecture B, then we have a bound on the size of the solution. Okay, so let's do the following. K0 is a number field. C over K0 is a smooth projective geometrically connected curve of genus 2 over the field K0 of genus 2. And let's consider M an ample line bundle on C. Now I can look at the set of algebraic points of C, C of Q bar, and there is a map from the set of algebraic points to real numbers, which is called the logarithmic height. So HM is called the logarithmic height of the curve attached to M. So I said what it was in the last hour. It depends only on M, does not depend on the choice of a metric or model, but it's well defined up to a bounded amount. So that's the old theory of height, where you define the logarithmic height as a quantity defined modulo bounded constant. K0 is a number field. So the theorem is that, assume conjecture B holds, then for any epsilon positive exist beta epsilon such that for any field containing K0, for any point P in C of F, the logarithmic height of P is bounded as follows. It's less or equal to 1/4 plus epsilon times the degree of M D of K, maybe I mean D of K0 actually, D of K0, D of F over the degree of F over Q plus O of 1, that is beta epsilon. So the theorem says that if we have a bound on omega 2, we have a bound on the height of points on curve of genus at least 2 in that case.
What is D of F? Discriminant?
D of F was defined as log of the discriminant. Log. Okay, so to prove the theorem is to consider the Kodaira consortium. That is, we introduce this curve y0, y1, y2, and the model xs over ys. So we have L0, which is M on y0 plus a metric, plus any metric. On Y1, we have the pullback. We have L2, the same way. We have a line model on the generic fiber of YS. So call it Y, and you assume that you have extended the metric and the line model to a model, to the model YS. Okay. Now we shall use the lemma which I first proved in the preceding hour. So define XS as follows. So I will use additive notation for the Picard group. So this is the line model L minus degree of L0, 1 plus epsilon, over 6, and here I have a line bundle, namely here I have a stable curve, therefore I have a relative dualizing sheaf omega s. I take the Arakelov metric on this relative dualizing sheaf, so I have omega bar s on xs. Xs is a family of curve on YS, so that we have the construction by the line of a line model omega bar S omega bar S on the base, which is an arithmetic surface. So this is an element in the arithmetic Picard group of YS times the Q. I assume that epsilon is in Q. Okay. So we shall apply the lemma to XS. For this, we consider the restriction of XS to the generic fiber. Then we have the degree of X, which is the degree of L minus degree of L0, 1 plus epsilon over 6. And here we have omega, gamma omega, where now I am looking at this construction, but generically. We have x to y, we have omega on x, and we have a line model omega, omega on y, which is the algebraic counterpart of what I was saying in the arithmetic case.
Geometrically, why is a curve except a surface?
Yes.
And so arithmetically, to NCRT.
So here I have dimension 1, dimension 2. Here I have dimension 2, YS is an arithmetic surface, and XS is dimension 3. But the line gives us this pairing from XS to YS because the relative dimension is 1. Okay. So now look at omega 2, which is by definition the degree k of omega, omega. Omega, omega is a line model on y, which is a smooth projective curve. Therefore, there is a degree, call it omega 2. And what you can show is that it's the same as omega 2 for x2 here I have y and here I have x. And now here I have morphism of degrees, the degree of y over y2 by definition. So omega omega is here. I claim this is the same as omega omega on y2 multiplied by the degree. This is because some diagram is commutative and Cartesian actually. So here we have a Cartesian diagram, here we have omega, here we have omega 2, the inverse image of omega 2 is omega, therefore the inverse image of omega 2 squared is omega 2, and the degree is multiplied by the degree of the ascension. Okay. And this is the same. So this can be computed. I mean, omega 2 squared, which is really the intersection of C1 of omega 2 is itself on the surface Y2, can be computed, and one finds 6. One finds 12, actually. So we get here 6 degree of y over y0. So now if I look at the expression degree k of x, I get that this is equal to degree k of l minus degree k of L0 multiplied by the degree of y over y0 times 6 times 1 plus epsilon. So this times 1 plus epsilon. And it's not hard to see that the degree of L is the degree of L0 multiplied by the degree of the extension, just because L is a pullback of L0. So here I get minus epsilon degree k of L0 degree of y over y0. And this is negative. So we have checked the condition of the dilemma, that XS defined this way, such that its degree on the generic fiber is strictly negative.
How did you get the 6?
This is a computation which I am not explaining.
Okay, okay. So it's not the same as the genus 6 as before?
It's related. It has to do with the geometry of this ramified cover. And you want to compute the intersection of omega in the cover.
It's not simply the fact that you have a genus 6.
But it's very close. It comes from the fact that omega is given by the Horowitz formula. So, and then you compute the intersection. Okay. So we can conclude, so by the lemma, we know that the degree hat of u upper star of xs is at most O of R. Because we know that the degree of xs on the generic fiber is strictly negative. Okay, so what does this inequality mean? By the definition of XS, this is the degree of U star, upper star of L bar S less or equal to degree L0 1 plus epsilon over 6 degree of omega bar s, and the pullback. Okay, so now we will go down in the tower which I raised, you know, the tower here. I mean, we are computing here at this point. And then we shall go down to Y0. So we do it as follows. By assumption, we have a field F which is a finite extension of K0, and we have a point P in C of F. So the first fact, which I will not prove, and which is proved in the Moret-Bailly paper I referred to last time, that is, we can assume that K equals K0. That is the first step where we extend K0 to K is the identity. So now we don't have to worry about C anymore, just Y0. And we can say the following. We have a point in CF, which is now the same as Y0 of F. And we want to lift Y0 all the way to XS in order to compare the height over there. Well, what happens is that the map from Y2 to Y0 is surjective as a map of scheme. So this means that there exists an extension F2 and a point, which I write P2 on Y2 of F2, such that, well, the two points P and P2 are essentially the same, namely, I have Y2, F2, this maps into Y2, I have Y0 of F0 of F, where there is P. I can look at its image in Y0 of F2, or I look at Y2 of F2 and P2 here. So it's not exactly the case that the image of P2 is P, but they become equal when extended scalars. So we get the same point, whether we go this way or this way. So we could say that we have extended P to Y2.
No, F0, what is F0? You say an extension F0, F2 of F0, but what is F0?
F0? Qu'est-ce qu'il est devenu?
Maybe it was before.
Non, non.
Okay. Right.
Yeah, so I choose a point downstairs and I lift it progressively to Y2 and then to Y.
Oh, you started with C. Then you go to Y0.
So really, this is a statement. So we are on F0, and we go up to Y2, and next we have to go from Y2 to Y. So we do the same construction. I'm sorry for the technicality of. So again, the map from Y to Y2 is surjective. So it's essentially surjective on rational point. So there exists an extension f of f2 such that there exists a point P in YF such that if I consider YF, I can go to YF2. I can also go from Y2F2 to YF2. So here I have P. Now I have P2 here. I think that's okay. So the point P and P2 correspond by this diagram. It's not exactly the case that the image of P is P2, but up to finite extension, that's the case. Okay. Now let T be the spectrum of F. Call XT the stable model of XP, the fibrite P of X. We have a diagram like this, and this diagram is Cartesian by the unicity of stable model on T. We have also another Cartesian product, namely xt goes to xt2 if I extend scalars from t2 to t, I get the same stable model. Okay. So we have this inequality degree of restriction of LS is less or equal to degree at 0, 1 plus epsilon of 6 times this degree here. So really, degree of U upper star omega bar S omega bar S is the same as the degree of omega T omega T. Because this diagram is commutative and Cartesian. So if I pull back omega s, I get omega t. And the same for the intersection. So we have degree hat u star l bar s is at most degree at 0, 1 plus epsilon over 6, degree hat of omega bar t, which is nothing else than the arithmetic intersection product of omega bar t with itself. Now let's use the other Cartesian product here to prove that omega 2 omega bar 2 omega bar t is the same as omega T2 omega bar T2 times the degree f over f2. So this is by this product here. Now we apply conjecture B. That is, we have omega 2, which is an upper bound for the height. And by conjecture B, omega bar square is bounded above from by log of this discriminant. Conjecture B implies that for any epsilon, there exists a constant beta epsilon such that omega bar 2, omega bar t2 square is at most 3 over 2 plus epsilon d of f2 plus beta epsilon degree of f2 over q. This is what conjecture B says. That this right-hand side here can be bounded above by log of the discriminant. So we are almost done. Because if we put this inequality together with the one we have already for degree of u upper star of L bar S, we get the following. Degree hat of u upper star LS is at most f over f2 degree L0. And now we have 3 over 2 times 1 over 6. So this is 1 over 4. 1 over 4 plus epsilon df2 over the degree of f2 over q plus some constant of 1 beta epsilon, let's say. So we have almost proved that the height of a point is bounded above by the discriminant, but we need, it's not exactly the statement we want, because we want a statement on F0. We want a statement downstairs. So while here we use the fact that Y2 to Y1 is etal, to get that df2 over f2 over q is less than df0 over f0 over q plus or of 1. So this is a statement in the paper by Moret-Bailly. We know that y2 to y1 is etal. Therefore, at the level of fields, the only ramified primes are those already ramified in F0 and those ramified, those sitting outside the open set where the map is etal. So we have a bounded set which is independent of the choice of points, which is the open set where this map is etal. Complement. Etal finite.
No, finite. The finite set is a complement of the open.
Yes, yes. Okay. So we can replace the right-hand side here by df0 over f0. And the last fact is that the height of P is the same as the height for L0 of P0. What do I mean by the height? I mean precisely this number, the degree of the pullback of L bar S on T. And as I said in the proof of the lemma, this degree does not depend on the metric up to bounded constant, and does not depend on the model up to bounded amount. So the logarithmic height is really the Arakelov height up to constant. And this formula is true by adjunction, because L is the inverse image of L0, and P0 is the image of P. So finally, we get the following: H L0 P0 less or equal to degree L0 1 plus epsilon over 4 df0 over F0 over Q plus O over 1. The height of the point which started within the theorem is bounded above by the discriminant. So this is what we wanted to show, that the height is bounded by the discriminant times the degree. So I hope the rest of the course will be less painful than today. Are there questions? What?
So big O of 1.
The big O of 1, all the constants depend on a compactness argument. I mean, when we compare two heights, we say that they are equal up to constant by taking the supremum of phi. So this is very badly controlled. The constant is obtained by sup on the compact set, and it would require a lot of work to give an explicit constant.
What is the uniformity with respect to phi? That you said in the beginning. Bounded in a certain algebraic family, the constant is the same.
Yeah, the family I was talking about in the conjecture is precisely the Kondragar family. We apply to the Kondragar family the statement of conjecture B. So it remains bounded in this family, which is more precise than saying it's bounded in some projective family. Okay, so next time we shall see that the effective model implies ABC. Thank you very much.